We are talking fiction, short films, and a stack of records that he and I and you probably love. Let's get to it. All right, Josh, welcome. Welcome to the show, man. Thank you for making the drive down to Boulder. We will be we'll be up in your neck of the woods soon, I think. I think we're making our big office move in the next couple months. So we'll be not technically neighbors, but close.
Right.
But yeah, man, I'm excited. Thank you for doing this. Everybody listening, as a quick background, I know Josh. I met you in our mutual friend's backyard at a bonfire. I think that's pretty much how I met everybody between 2014 and 2015. I was out there smoking cigarettes, as I was wont to do in those days, and we were talking about, I don't remember what the group was, but you and I ended up talking about, I think we were either talking about The Dark Knight or another movie that for some reason The Dark Knight reminds me of, or we were talking about graphic novels. And I can't remember exactly which one it was. I've been trying to figure it out. I knew this was happening. I've been going back, like, what is the Josh and Tyler, like, sort of proto history? And I can't figure it out. But anyway, we met there. We've been friends now for, a year and a half or 2 years? Our life has been very crazy. So we haven't actually hung out, like, more than maybe 10 times during that time. Both of us are very busy. You have a kid, you're married, I have stepkids, I'm married now. Right. But you also have an awesome podcast called Ink and Echo, which you were nice enough to have me on in December, which was a great conversation. It was one of those sort of like cathartic things. I would imagine that everybody who comes on your show feels the same way getting off of it, as if they've sort of taken, they've just spent just the right amount of time in this like Epsom salts bath for the soul.
Well, I mean, we got a lot of really positive response from that episode. I think people appreciated what you had to say, but what's funny, not everybody wants to go there. You know, not everybody wants to go deep. They want to, some people keep it very surface and they're just like, yeah, I play guitar in a band. Like, see you later.
Yeah. What's the, like, well, tell me this. You don't need to call anybody out by name, but you can.
Yeah.
What is, like, the most banal interview that you guys have done on Ink and Echo? Like, what was one where it was like you were stoked about it and then came away from it and were like, that was probably just dumb or a waste of time?
I don't think any of them have been a waste of time. And I honestly am grateful to everyone who's been willing to come on. I would say the one that at least got out of Andy and I's hands, Andy, my co-host, was Skylar Kroom, the singer of He Is Legend. I still ended up loving that talk. He's a super funny dude. But I think he had had a decent amount to drink by the time he got on the mic. And he's just, he will talk and talk. And so that one just ended up being, we didn't even get to any of our questions. Because he just kind of rolled for it and was going all over the place. But I mean, there was still some good stuff in there.
Yeah.
But Andy and I got off and it was just like, you know, you're changing your tire on the side of the road and a semi flies past and you feel kind of wind blown. And that was kind of the sensation of like, what happened?
Oh my totally. God. No, that's good. That's true. Yeah. I think I feel the same way about our show. I mean, I wouldn't say that any of them have been dumb or a waste of time, I guess. Maybe that's a bad lead in, but certainly there are ones that you sort of get on the ride and you can't get back off.
Yeah.
So that's awesome.
And if we ever had one go truly bad, or if the guest was just not into it, you know, we probably just wouldn't post it.
Yeah.
But, you know, fingers crossed that hasn't happened yet.
Yeah, totally. Has that happened for us? There have been a few that have not made it. There have been a bunch that have not made it because of quality. So, like, somebody calling in on a cell phone on the road, which is fine. I mean, that's their, you know, their life is busy. But where, you know, a quarter of the audio is just not there or usable.
Yeah, that's heartbreaking.
I had one that went really badly. I won't say who it is, but it went really badly. It lasted less than 10 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
And I made up an excuse to get off of it because it, like, there was no way to recover it.
Yeah.
And so I didn't say anything like, it wasn't anything bad. It wasn't, right. or like, inappropriate or something. It just was headed nowhere. And it was just better for everybody, I think, to just pull pull the plug on that, which I still have a good laugh about every once in a while. And maybe that person and I will also have a good laugh about it next time I see them. But yeah, man, I think I know you've been really busy with this film, Cordial Kill.
Yeah.
You did a crowdfunding thing to, there are a lot of crowdfunding platforms out there now. Which one you used?
Kickstarter.
The big okay.
one, yeah.
Yeah. I couldn't remember. I know, I think I gave like $20 to it, I think.
Yeah,
But I'm super excited about it. I think it's, it was like this thing that I remember you, and it's one of the things I've always liked about you. I think there are, I have been this person, the kind of person that I don't like. You have not been the kind of person that I don't like, where you go to a party, you talk to someone about something they're doing, and then it never happens, right? And you never hear about it again.
Sure.
There was, I went through a long period of my life, probably 3 or 4 years, where there was probably no one I was unwilling to tell I was working on a book and describe it in great detail to them, and then made very little progress on it in the actual world. So you were different than that, which was something that I like really admired about you. I remember you had, you've mentioned a few things. You've written a few books. So you've written, they tend to be like, I don't know what the right word is.
It's usually, I mean, it's genre fiction.
Yeah,
like
dystopian. Like, I mean, you, the Dr. Gaines stuff is, you wrote, I think the most recent one was like a zombie novel, right?
Well, or, it was about a hallucinogenic drug.
Oh, that's right. Yeah.
And ultimately kind of an anti-apocalyptic novel, cause I'm so not down with all the zombie stuff, but that's popular in our culture right now. But yeah, I mean, I've written all over the place. I've written kind of a weird, like a Western crime story. I've written I just like stories about obsessive characters, people who kind of start doing some odd thing that is not normal in the regular world. I don't even mean alcohol or drugs. It's like an obsessive practice that then becomes like it encompasses their whole life.
Yeah.
Because that's just an interesting thing to me. But anyway, yes, written a few things, and the genre is usually all over the place.
So. Yeah. Huh. So, and where do you get these, this is always an interesting thing that I try to infer from reading people's books, which is probably not always the best way to do that, but how much, certain authors are writing themselves into a character or certain characters in a particular novel. So, I'm reading It right now. It's like this Leviathan thing. I'm about halfway through, and, there is a character in there, Bill Dembro, who at least says certain things, the older version of him says certain, or the, his and biographical things about him remind me of Stephen King, or things that seem to have been true about Stephen King at different times. Like he has this kind of explosion in writing school where he's like, everybody's saying his writing isn't sociopolitical enough and whatever. And he's like flips out and makes fun of everyone because he sells a novel or sells a short story and makes a bunch of money. And anyway, it's this whole thing. And I don't even know if that's true about Stephen King. It just seems like some of the stuff that he's saying is stuff that I've heard him say in interviews. All that to say, what degree do you... So you have a, you know, you have this fascination with like a snowballing obsession. Like a really peculiar snowballing obsession, which I think is like a really interesting... thing. Like a really interesting, I don't know what the right word is, like trope or structure or something. Is that like, does that stuff, is that something that like, is that an outworking of stuff you were worried about in yourself? Is it a topic that you've seen in other people? Is it something like what's the hook there for you?
Well, so to the first thing you said, I hope that I have completely run out of putting myself in my books anymore.
Yeah.
Because... not to go on a long tangent, the very first novel that I wrote that never came out, there was way too much of me in there. It was a stupid premise about a dog that could read and talk and like befriended a homeless guy in downtown Denver. It was ridiculous. I was a much younger person. And I thought I was being cute and clever and putting all these little Easter eggs in there of like my own personality that people who knew me in real life would find funny or smart or whatever. So I hope all that's gone. And now just my characters are not me whatsoever. With the occasional like opinion or comment that comes out that might be my own that comes out through their mouth. But then as far as the obsession thing, the addiction thing, I mean, that comes from, I think, the films of Paul Thomas Anderson.
Okay.
That comes definitely from the books of Chuck Palahniuk. Because so many of his stories involve a very similar thing. And it's not like I'm trying to copy him. It's just that is a fascinating thing to me. The fact that I do think people in our world get addicted and obsessed with odd things, and just fiction allows you to take those to a further extreme than real life usually does. So I don't know. And at least personally, I'm not smart enough to like write in these deeper meanings or symbols or metaphors. Like it, I just like to write about what is weird to me. And I'm like, what if somebody collected a semi-truck full of glass bottles and tried to take them to Michigan to cash them in all at once.
Yeah.
You know, what if a woman in Pagosa Springs tried to like sewed bath towels together end to end until her entire house was filled with towels? It's like, what the fuck kind of premise is that? But I hope that, and those are actual stories I'm describing.
No, totally.
It's just interesting to me. And even the idea of objects and texture and just, you know, why someone gets obsessed with something that is so simple and bizarre.
Right.
I just really like that.
Yeah, I like that too. It seems like an interesting, that premise, that central premise for all of those stories, I think is a really interesting companion piece, I think, to our generation's obsession with finding out who we are. Mm-hmm. Right. Because I think what's true about most people in the quote unquote process of finding out who, finding yourself, is that you end up being really fucking bizarre in some way. Like, I think that probably everyone is bizarre in some way, right? Like, it could be something small, it could be something huge, but where you have propensities or tendencies for/towards things that you probably have, most people or everyone has probably, like, suppressed in some way, or maybe not even totally... might not even have the internal vocabulary to like talk about to themselves, if that makes sense, right?
Yeah.
Like, because I think like anyway, that's a really fascinating thing. I like that idea, and it does. You're right. It does remind me of Chuck Palahniuk's books quite a bit. Mm-hmm. I am. It reminds me a lot of Diary.
Yes,
especially.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's interesting. Like, it's the internet has created a weird place. Right? Because this idea of like, what would you do if no one is watching is a thing that we, for some reason, are obsessed with exploring, a question we're obsessed with exploring in very public platforms, right? Like the idea, for instance, as horrendous as this is, of dancing like nobody's watching, right? Mm-hmm. How many things, I mean, you could go on Pinterest and see 50,000 posts of like quote that quote or other quotes like it of like people reminding themselves to, I guess on Pinterest and posting to things that they want to be this way instead of just writing it on a little shitty sticky note and putting it on the driving like the steering wheel of their car. Sure. Do you know what I mean? Where it's like we have this like we need an audience to explore our what we say we aspire to having, which is no audience. Isn't that weird?
Yeah, yeah.
Anyway, I just think your novels, your stories then are like really interesting companion pieces to that because it's like real world absurdity that isn't happening on Twitter or isn't happening.
Sure.
I've never thought about it
like that. But yeah, I like that. I hope that's true.
So what if, before we move on, where can we buy your books?
Oh, sure. I mean, just they're on Amazon. Just search Dr. Gaines, and that's Dr. the word,
not
you know,
the
spelled
abbreviation.
Out. Yeah. And if I could just say,
and Gaines
real quick
is Gaines, correct?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay. That would have been awkward.
The film, not to, you alluded to it, and then we didn't get to say anything. So that is along slightly different lines. It's not quite as much of the obsessive thing, but just so that the short film Cordial Kill that I raised $5,800 to make. I don't know. My brain goes a lot of places with this. I mean, that spawned out of a novel that I was writing. Cordial Kill is literally the first chapter of a novel that one honestly might not ever get finished. A novel called Blacktop City that I wanted it to be essentially like my Pulp Fiction. Mm-hmm. Because it takes place in the 80s in Los Angeles. It's about mob guys, but it's about completely incompetent mob guys and even blends in some not supernatural, but some facets that cannot happen in the real realm. Just some weird little, you know, tiny little things like the briefcase that, you know, John Travolta opens up and it's gold. And anyway, something like that. But so in this case, you know, people, I'm a very big Tarantino fan, and I know that is no longer original to be a Tarantino fan, but people kind of shit all over his movie Death Proof. And granted, it's not his best movie at all. But in an interview, he talked about how, you know, there's these very long periods, 40 minutes or an hour, where you're literally just hanging out with these four women, driving around, talking, going to a bar, like, you know, and some viewers, or maybe a lot, would be like, where the hell is this going? Right. I'm kind of bored. I am fascinated by that. I love the fact of a movie that can just be sort of, just that, just hanging out with these characters, hearing their dialogue, getting a very deep sense of who they are, almost like with a novel. You spend a lot of time with people. So anyway, in this short film, that is what I set out to do in my writing. It's very dialogue heavy. There's only three scenes, but it's going to be, I mean, it's going to end up being probably 30 minutes and, okay. Just lots of talking. It's these guys driving around. They go to a bar. You know from the beginning that they've been tasked with killing someone. But it's unclear until the end what they're really doing and even what their relationship is. Okay. And so, you know, I hope there's like an element of mystery happening, but also that people just get engrossed in the characters. And so unfortunately I'm talking about this while it's still months from being finished. It's all been shot and stuff, and I'm currently cutting it together right now, which is destroying my life.
But, yeah, I can imagine.
Anyway, I don't know. There's a lot of crummy short films out there, and there's a lot of amazing ones, you know, don't get me wrong. But I wanted to set out to do, like, put the bar as high as possible, you know, in making this a really believable period piece, you know, buying a 1986 car, like, under my own name.
Really?
Buying a car so that we could use it for the film.
Wow.
So I hope it'll have enough of those little magic elements that'll set it apart from just, like, a silly little short film about a guy falling for a girl, and it's like, oh, that was adorable, and it's gonna go nowhere.
Yeah.
That sounded arrogant, I'm sorry.
No, dude, no, it's great. No, exactly. No, I think there's, I don't know about, I guess it's an interesting setting to me, because I think crime settings / whatever we can, I mean, that can bleed into a lot of different things at this point, but I guess the gang related crime, like the classic, like, mob films, those have sort of bloomed into all sorts of things. Like, Jennifer and I are getting ready to watch The Wire, which I've seen a few episodes of. But anyway, all that saying that, I think, like, crime / mob stuff as a backdrop is always interesting to me, because it's not a place where, like, the character's quote-unquote badness is the obvious thing. That's like sort of the extroverted trait in the story, is that they kill people for a living, or they, I don't know, whatever they do, right? And then people can come after me with the war on drugs stuff. I don't think there should be a war on drugs. This is not a political podcast. So my point being, they launder money, they sell drugs, whatever it is. Yeah. And then you're dealing with their humanity inside of that context. Whereas, like, most other movies, the exploration is digging down through supposedly good people to their bad parts, right?
And
and it's like an interesting context for me, because it gets all of the, like, moral shit that people want to worry about almost, like, the obvious stuff out of the way. It's like, yes, these people aren't great, right? By maybe the viewer's standard. So, I mean, that's a subjective claim. Mm-hmm. But let's say, you know, if you're against people selling drugs, you're watching it and you're like, oh man, they do this thing that I think is bad. Mm-hmm. But now what, right? And it's like a really interesting, like, okay, well, the story isn't about that. And like, it's never about that, right?
Right, right.
And I think for most crime movies, the story is never about the crime as much as it is the people. And so I think that's, I'm excited about that. I think that'll be, I'm excited to see it.
Sure. Not to dwell on this. I mean, it's not, the movies that end up not being interesting are just where the bad guy's like so bad. Like he's pretty much just a Bond villain and wants to take over the world. That's not, it's like, okay, we've seen that. But you know, Tony Soprano from the very beginning, you know, he's a horrible person, but then they work backwards and you start to care about him and like realize how he's hurting. Walter White starts doing something horrific for like kind of okay.
Yeah.
Kind of justifiable reasons. Mm-hmm. You know, he's trying to save his family. He has nothing to lose. And so, yeah, that's what's interesting is bad people kind of doing things for good reasons.
Which I would, and I don't have any data to support this, but I would imagine that that is true more often than not. Mm-hmm. I think the idea of, man, this is a whole different podcast. I would imagine though that like the idea of total badness is something that has basically operated in societies as like political and socioeconomic weapons more than it has ever actually been true. I think the interesting thing is that the conversations in philosophy class, when you're in college or wherever, high school, you know, there's the people who always want to test the moral principle for the Hitlers of the world, right? Mm-hmm. And the fact is that like almost every, like they're such outliers, morally speaking, that like, what I mean by outliers in that like they're, what seems to be the depth of their depravity and then their access to like extend their personal depravity over other people, right? Is like a huge outlier. Most people, even that could be totally bad, would never have like
that sort of influence.
Yeah. Or, they would be like the same as if Stalin got shipwrecked on an island and we never knew he existed. I mean, maybe he just sat there and thought dark thoughts all the time, but it, you know what I mean? Like he would have had, so anyway, what I mean is like in that sense, I think a lot of people, one, are never that bad, and two, like never, and so like the moral questions, like the really interesting moral questions, I think, and maybe cinema and arts, the arts in general have helped us over the last 60 years or 50 years or something to slowly start zooming in that like the really interesting moral questions are the ones that apply to everybody else, right? The sort of capable of bad, capable of good. Maybe a slight disposition towards one or the other for different reasons, and then exploring what happens or what they do, right? Like the individual, I think, in everyday society has, it's a lot more interesting because it's us, I think, right? And so it maybe treats, James Bond is not us, right? We don't relate at all to anything that happens in James Bond. Mm-hmm. I mean, they're fun to watch, I guess, but I mean, it's not, but I think the moral transformation of somebody like Walter White is more true of what we could call modern man than Christoph Waltz in Spectre, right? Sure. And even in that, maybe he's not completely bad. I was just thinking about that the other day. But anyway, does it, you know what I mean? Like it's not,
certainly.
That's an interesting point. All that to say, I'm excited to see the movie. It's called Cordial Kill. And it will be where? Are you doing a releasing for it? Or are you?
That's a great question. I mean, so all the Kickstarter backers, they'll get it first. They'll get a high resolution digital copy. And then it does have to go on the festival circuit, to use a silly term that I don't even know what it means. Before it can publicly come out on Vimeo or YouTube or any of those. And I'd like to have a premiere in town.
Okay.
That we may possibly have access to a really nice theater at DU. So anyway, we'll see.
Yeah.
More to come on that and whenever it's done.
Cool, man. Yeah. Well, I am excited to see it. Everybody listening, you need to keep track of Cordial Kill. Is there like a Facebook group for it, or
I mean that you know,
I'm not saying there should be
me on the social places,
Dr. Gaines on Twitter,
FB and Twitter.
So I guess jumping from there, I think I know you've brought a few records you want to talk about.
Yeah.
And as always, I'm sure that those conversations will go in all sorts of different directions.
Yeah.
And I'm excited about this. You have like quite a different, well, I think if you went record to record, they're quite different from each other.
Yeah. I tried to pick a spectrum of genres.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I was excited. The first one that when you sent the email over a few weeks ago, I was excited that you led off with Morning Phase by Beck.
Yeah.
I love Beck. We just got to work with him on
Odelay.
Yeah. And so, and Morning Phase to me, for me, is probably my favorite Beck record.
Me too.
Tell me a little bit about this record. So I know, so Beck is, has become this sort of aging indie cowboy figure, right? Where it felt like Beck was always doing Beck. Like he, everybody was, and that he sort of, and that the person, like the, there's like an icon version of Beck, and then there's like Beck the person, right? And I think that that, the marriage of those two things sort of happened probably Odelay timeframe of like Beck becoming like a larger than himself cultural force almost.
Sure.
But Morning Phase was, I mean, that's, so that's his 2014 project. Mm-hmm. Is that right? That's, he won the Grammy
2 years
ago. He won Album of the Year for it.
Or
three years ago. Yeah. But to me, so tell me about Morning Phase. So this is obviously, this is like a record that is deep into his creative arc. Mm-hmm. It is, he had been capital B Beck for quite some time at this point.
Yeah.
And he put out a record that was very, like almost like a one sort of continual meditation. Mm-hmm. It felt like,
yeah, it's very much one piece. Yeah.
Yeah. So tell me what, how you found, like, when did you first listen to it? What has it, why has it stuck with you?
Yeah. So what's curious is Beck isn't even really one of my big artists. Mm-hmm. Frankly, there are some of his albums I do not like at all. And I, there's some I don't even think I've ever listened to all the way through. So, I mean, I remember buying Mutations in high school and liked it because it's kind of artsy and weird. And I don't know, I've come to recognize that Beck is now someone who really redefines himself from record to record. It, I mean, I think in a more intense way than some other artists, where he's truly doing completely different genres. Anyway, but so Morning Phase came at a time in 2014 where I had pretty much stopped absorbing any new music.
Mm-hmm.
I was 26 at the time, and I don't know, I already felt like one of those old guys who's like, I don't understand this new music, like I don't care, I'm just gonna kind of listen to what I listen to. And and that's still sort of true to this day. Like I don't feel like I have the mental bandwidth to sit down with, you know, some new record. Like on the one hand, it just doesn't interest me very much, but yeah, that was one where, I don't know, it might have just been I saw it pop up on Spotify new releases or something, and I was like, huh, that's kind of a different cover for him. He's got long hair, like he's going through a midlife crisis.
Yeah.
Listen to it, and there's something about those songs that I truly believe they embody the term timeless, because they all, to me, those melodies sound like every other song I've ever heard, or not even that. It's like I recognize them all and I can't pinpoint where they came from, but for something about them is so comforting and endearing, that you just, putting on that record almost like puts me at ease, you know, and lets me sort of forget about life for a little bit in a beautiful way. It's almost like a not post-rock, but it's almost like an instrumental record. It's so easy to listen to, almost as if it's instrumental music.
Yeah. So, yeah. No, I remember when it first came out, I was going to a friend's wedding in Charlotte. And this is like a really stupid series of thoughts, but it's just true. I was there. I didn't want to look fat in my suit. And so my logical conclusion was, I am going to put on morning phase because I hadn't heard it yet. And I'm just going to run until I can't run anymore. That ended up being like 7 miles through sort of downtown Charlotte, listening to morning phase many, like a few times in a row. It took me a long time to run 7 miles. Uh-huh. I hope I never run 7 miles again.
Right. Just to be clear, you were trying to like drop weight.
I was trying to drop weight. Or? No, it was like, yeah. So I went on this run at 9:30 in the morning. I think I got home at like 11:30 or 12. And I had to then take a shower, get dressed, and go to the wedding.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah, man. That's a lot. That says a lot about what 2014 Tyler was like. So,
right.
Anyway, it did nothing for me as far as helping single Tyler not be single. It did not help me fit into my suit better. But it did strike me while I was running and listening to it over and over again that it was like the best. It was like the best for me at the time. It was the best Beck record I've ever heard.
Mm-hmm.
And it just felt like this album that existed almost outside of time. It was this, kind of in the way that you said, it was like that. I think that's a really interesting way to say that. Like you recognize all of it, but you can't pinpoint it mm-hmm. at all. Mm-hmm. Have you had other experiences like that with other groups, like that specific one?
Very few. And I mean, one of the other ones is one of these on my list, but yeah, it's sort of it's almost undefinable, but it's just like something that you recognize on some subconscious level of you know, maybe if you really were able to mentally dig down, like some part of a melody might come from a Beatles song or from some other iconic artist, Johnny Cash or something. But you're probably never going to take the time to like find out. And, you know, there's no reason to, but yeah, it hasn't happened very often where a record just when you listen to it for the first time, it sounds familiar. Yeah.
Yeah. And it just feels like it like fits mm-hmm. right away.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. No, that's good. What, and I know like what role does, sort of this meditative music have? And when I say meditative, I don't mean like a chiropractor's office,
mm-hmm.
you know, where it's just sort of the sound of someone hitting one chime.
Right.
But the idea of just this sort of, it almost feels like this thing that's evolving slowly in front of you from like a batch of sounds, like almost
right.
a tiny bit Brian Eno-ish, where it's like, mm-hmm. oh man, this is taking these concepts and then digesting them and digesting them and digesting them and looping them.
Yeah.
This is like on the border of that, but is this a kind of music that you listen to a lot? Is it something that is like kind of an outlier in your taste or?
Yeah, I would say this one is not one of my more common listening. I don't even know how to phrase it. There was a period where I was into a ton of instrumental music, kind of the post-rock stuff of Caspian and This Will Destroy You and things like that. And this in a way kind of fits it in there in my mind.
Mm-hmm.
And I guess all I can say as to the meditative quality is with Beck's record, it's able to most of the time take me away from the normal anxiety and depression that's going through my head constantly mm-hmm. and allow me to just think about, or not even think about thinking,
mm-hmm.
you know, which can sometimes lead to some really creative thoughts.
Right.
But just, yeah, somehow calming down, setting aside regular life and just kind of letting you ride on this, lazy river of an album, and chill out a little
yeah.
bit. Which is lovely, and not many records do that.
Yeah. Yeah. No, and chilling out is an interesting pursuit and a good one. How do you What does that look like for you? I mean, I know we've talked offline about both of our struggles with anxiety and depression and things like that. But what is that? What does that look like for you on a day-to-day basis as far as what you were describing? Like the way that you manage that or channel it?
Yeah. This could go many places, but I'll try to be concise. Well, for one thing, that has meant... I mean, I've started doing the really cheap, fast American version of meditating, which is like Headspace app, 10 minutes a day. I read a book last year that talked about the importance of how you begin the first hour of the day basically sets the trajectory for the rest of the day. Mm. So, I mean, if you're waking up hungover and like rushing out the door to work and like slamming coffee and, you know, jumping adrenaline into your system, you're probably going to have a shitty day. You're probably going to eat badly. You're going to feel like shit. It's just, that's not the way to begin. That's not the way to take care of yourself. And, so, and even to this day, I still have, you know, good and bad days in regards to taking care of myself. But, on the one thing I sort of discovered last year was just, I've tried to pull away as much as possible from social media and from even being online. You know, I deleted my personal Facebook and now just have a secret account just so I can be the admin of my Dr. Gaines page. I am pretty much never on Instagram unless I'm posting an Ink and Echo thing. And Twitter is kind of the only one where I still, like an addict, return to and want to pull away from that. But just I was noticing that those were... you don't go online for an hour and get off and feel great. Mm-hmm. You usually feel like garbage. And sometimes you're not even sure why. Mm-hmm. And, I was just like, why am I returning to these things that make me feel horrific, that make me feel like everyone else's life is happier than mine, or that where I read these opinions and I think, oh, is that true about me? So getting, I'm probably way off
the question. No, this is perfect.
I've tried to remove social media. I've tried to meditate. I've tried to just in general slow down my life, you know, to where I'm not reading 75 articles a day online and just sort of almost trying to get to the point where, I mean, I have to use the internet for my job, but letting through the course of my work day, letting that be the only time I'm online. Mm-hmm. And the rest of it just slowing down. And our culture is not down with that because we think that productivity and success is everything. And, I'm really learning and trying to train myself to believe that is simply is not true. And, I will not feel more fulfilled as a person at the end of the day or at the end of my life just because I accomplished a bunch of shit. You know, a quote along these lines, and this is a paraphrase, but J.R.R. Tolkien talked about how one of the most evil inventions ever was the automobile, because it forced people to rush through the countryside instead of to walk through it and just experience it and breathe. And I know that sounds kind of archaic or hippie-ish, but I'm just like, no, people lived like that for way longer than the way people are living right now. Mm-hmm. This sort of thing where everything gets faster and more efficient. And I don't think that's to our benefit. I think we're more anxious, more depressed, more addicted, like, than ever right now. And it is because partly of social media, of this societal pressure. Anyway, that's, sorry.
No, totally.
I don't know where I am now.
No, that's perfect. And I think that's, you know, I think, well, there's a way, yes. So let me just, I'm going to shrink down 18 thoughts and say one.
Yeah.
I think that's really well said. I think that, so this idea of living your life in quiet desperation, right, is one of these lines that are, and that's not the actual line, but it, as far as referencing the idea of quiet desperation, seems to me to be something that we have self-diagnosed, but that may not actually be true. And to your point, only because I think there seems to be a heavy emphasis these days on unplugging. mm-hmm. from, let's say, people that work in tech, for instance. So you're on your computer all day. You work at a startup or a company that calls itself a startup, mm-hmm. or you work for a huge company, whatever it is, that people, they need to have access to you. And they tell you that they need to have access to you. Yes. And you need to have access to them. That's like this implicit thing in our phones or whatever it is. It doesn't matter. It could be anything mm-hmm. at this point, but primarily like our phones and then these networks that we're on. And it seems to me that I don't know. The quiet desperation thing is something that the idea of saying, I don't want to live in quiet desperation, right? Mm-hmm. The thing, if that's somebody's sort of subconscious goal, and so I'm plugged into all these things, I read all these things, I stay up on all these things, I now have like curated, self-curated opinions on all these topics,
yeah,
whatever we want to call it. I'm a part of these creative groups or this, whatever it is, that that we've never, I mean, that there's, we, first of all, we don't have any, I agree with you, I don't think there's any proof that people are happier because of it. And I think we don't even know that we're making a value judgment as soon as we say something like quiet desperation, as if being disconnected and not having access to, at least in our minds, not having access to the ability to believe that we are satisfying all of our desires, because I don't think we actually are, but we believe that we are. Not having access to things that let us believe that would cause desperation in us. And I think that and to your point, I think the truth is sort of perpendicular to that, in the sense that I think that people who unplug from things that are causing them to feel that way, mm-hmm. there's a process of going through and saying, like, and almost relearning the dimensions of your actual self in your actual world. But yeah, I think human beings in general were probably, for the most part, created to be very provincial creatures. We live in this town. We have these friends. Every once in a while, maybe we leave for a reason. Mm-hmm. But not that, like, the idea of being globetrotters in a tiny world where you can go and do anything at any given, at the drop of a hat, or think that you can, mm-hmm. seems to not have nearly as much upside as we thought it would. And maybe that just means that I maybe spent a lot of time living that way and got burnt out and then stopped. And I'm not projecting that on other people. I'm sure some people are very happy by it, but it is interesting, the expectations of that you combat. So let me ask you this. You're a creative dude. You make films, you write books, you have a great podcast. Those all seem to be outlets for what the bulk of your creative angst is already. Do you think that things like Twitter and Facebook or even just knowing about other creative people's stuff,
yeah.
and like seeing the highlights of their life all the time,
right.
and that's it, and not even knowing if what they're posting about their life is real,
yeah.
but that you mentioned that like thinking that other people's lives are better than yours,
mm-hmm.
How much does that affect you, and how much would you say, like, does that take you from an anxiety and depression level that maybe your creative outlets are managing for you, and are, mm-hmm. maybe that's like a healthy relationship for you, yeah. and it's just like hard sometimes, but it's like actually really good for you.
Mm-hmm.
What percentage would you say that these, like, basically perceptions of the outside world, we can just group all that into that phrase.
Yep.
How does that feed that, or feed sort of the worst parts of yourself, or the parts that you feel like are the most overwhelming?
Right.
Does that make sense?
Yeah. Oh, it has a huge effect. I mean, 2016, frankly, was like a year of paralysis for me creatively. And I it was because I published my last book in 2015, right at the end of 2015. And it, frankly, didn't sell very well, like, big surprise. But, 2016, I don't know if it was just the age I was at or what, but I just noticed that I was believing basically all the voices that were coming at me, not just online, but in the real world. And I mean, the easiest way to sum it up is just like, Josh, you're going to spend a bunch of time making something that maybe you love to make, and you're going to put it out into the world, and the world is going to say, that is worthless to us. Like, good job, you fucking loser. Like, sorry.
Yeah. No, Of course you can. Okay. This has been well below average.
I'll have to amp it up. Just kidding.
Yeah, dude, come on.
I literally could not write. I'd sit down and I had the free time to do it. I had some ideas and, sitting there at my computer with a blank Microsoft document, I would just think, why would I put hundreds of hours into this when I know it's going to come out and be worthless? And granted, I was in a really emotionally bad place to think that way, because that's not putting it out and getting any responses shouldn't be the reason to do it anyway. I mean, we kind of talked about that on Ink and Echo, but so I'm trying to just pull back and get back to basics, essentially, because I was listening to the world. I was thinking other people were bigger than me and that was like they were killing it, like that was the reason to live, basically. That just isn't true, and that's not healthy. And I've just, had to work backwards and try to remember you're doing these things because you're gifted to do them and because you love to do them. And that is reason enough. And, even faith plays into that. Some of just, believing I've been gifted by this being who I believe to be God, and even that... people's perceptions or reactions or response, good or bad, does not equate my value or the value of the thing I made.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
No, totally. Yeah, I think that's an interesting, that's a good way to put that. And I think the ability to inject more almost like agrarianism into your creative process and your life, because I don't think there's really a separation between those two things. Like, I think that I don't know. I mean, I think that there is, because it plays into a lot of, because I think a confusion on that point, right? So a confusion on the stuff, on the point that you're making, I think leads to a lot of other things that are confusing for people and untrue, which is like, I need to live a certain kind of life and have a certain kind of schedule, mm-hmm. and do a certain kind of thing in order to be creative, whatever that means. I used to think that for a long time. Mm-hmm. I used to think that I needed to be this like moody alcoholic dude who was sad all the time and was like, I had this like weird, that develops this like weird victim mentality, right? Where everything that happens is playing into this narrative of like, the world or people are secretly trying to like subvert you or hurt you, and that's what's fueling your art, right? Yeah. It's like this reaction against it. That story is untrue. Mm-hmm. I just had a drinking problem and was emotionally like 9 years old, and a lot of other things, right? And so it's interesting that a lot of people feel like my favorite writer did X, so I need to do X.
Yeah.
Or my favorite writer lived in X place, so I need to live in X place.
Yes.
Which is not obvious. I say that it's obviously untrue, but I don't think that there's a lot of people who don't think that it's obviously untrue. Mm-hmm. And I didn't think it was obviously untrue for a very long time. And I think in that sense, being creative can be really the pursuit of an emotional experience much more than the pursuit of creating something or creating art.
Oh, yeah.
Right?
Because the experience is so romantic in our perception of
mm-hmm.
it. Yeah.
And we come up with romantic context for ourselves. That's one of the reasons that I love... it's one of the reasons I love being married and I love being a stepdad, is that there's a context that is preeminently outside of myself that requires... and feeds into me like having two stepdaughters and a wife who legitimately like love me a lot, and where there's also lots of struggles back and forth between every, you know, whatever, with everybody, and they all have struggles with me. I think that that context is a real one. The idea of I am an unappreciated, brilliant writer is untrue. I am not brilliant, and I'm not a writer because I haven't published a book yet. So anyway, but my point being, though, is that like there's not a I will eventually. I just haven't. I hope is what I should say. Maybe I'll get hit by a bus and then I will not have published a book. My point being, though, is that I think like things like family, things like community, things like place, are things that I think anchor us to a world that is both bigger than us and glad that we're here in our context. The world in general doesn't care about us, but our small group of friends, the people we work with, our family, the city that we live in, we have roots into those things and we can care about each other, right? Which I think brings the individual down to a place where like you have the resources to do good in this place, right? Or to be honest in this place. Like you have the resources here to go to a friend and say, I know that I really hurt you. I was very immature. I'm very sorry, right? You can go say that to a person that you know. It's much different. It's much not, but not being anchored to that, I think, can lead to the that all those contexts either being shunned and not having, and then as a and then requisitely, I guess, not having the support of those things in your real life, and also I think kicks you further into an illusion, which is comfortable or comforting, but not true. Like you might, it leads to you listening to music late at night by yourself, getting really hyped up and being like, man, I identify with this artist, whoever that is. But then never allowing yourself to recognize that you wake up in a bed and go to a job and whatever as like impulses, because those things are impulses and actual obstacles. Like if I want to write a book, I have to cut other things out and find time, right? Rather than like, I kind of already have written a book in my mind, and people just don't appreciate my talent yet. Like they should just know. Do you know what I mean? Okay. I'm not putting that on you, but but I think that that's like a common, I would imagine that's a common struggle that creative people have in the digital age, whether they're making music or writing or making a film or whatever. And the Beck record is interesting, is funny to me because it's a record that's not just incredible, but it's like Beck, I think, pretty much played all the instruments on it and produced the whole thing. And he is a dude who just goes to a life like a brick and mortar studio still, plays like brick and mortar instruments and makes brick and mortar records, right? Which is like a really nice, that in the same way for me, maybe his music does that, knowing about him and knowing his processes and knowing what like what his regimen is and things like that is like another like in a constructively disillusioning thing. Does that make sense?
Yes. Yeah, certainly.
Yeah, and I think, I don't remember if you and I talked about this, there was a piece that I meant to send you. I will send you it to you after this that is about, I read it a few years ago and then I go back to it a lot about like how becoming disillusioned is like the best thing that will ever happen to you. And that if you have a friend who tells you that he's disillusioned, that you should encourage that because he's literally, or she is literally getting rid of illusions that they have about themselves or the world or whatever. And that the stuff that you were saying made me think of that. So yeah, man, I mean, it sounds like tough year, but good on the other side of it. Like that's a painful, maybe. I mean, I'm not, maybe it's not good yet.
Yeah.
It's still bad.
Yeah, bad still in like the, with the recognition that I'm enormously privileged and I was not suffering in any real way, but but just I recognized some big things about myself in 2016 and now I'm trying to make them better.
Let's move on to Dredg.
Sure.
I don't know anything about Dredg. And I want you to, so I listened a little bit to this record. I'm stoked to hear you tell us all about it. I'm sure there's listeners that also know Dredge and know the Pariah, the Parrot, and the Delusion, or know And. But tell me about this album and tell us a little bit about this band for people who don't know.
Yeah. So Dredge has been around for probably, 20 years or so now. They've got 5 records out, and I mean, this is a terrible term, but the simplest way to sum them up is like they're kind of an art rock band. And in that, all their albums are conceptual. They often either tell a story or sort of express these just concepts or ideas. And in that, you know, their albums are not songy songs usually. Mm-hmm. They're kind of like one giant flowing piece. And I don't know, that may sound pretentious, but it's really quite lovely. And it hit me at the right time of life. They did, which Andy Osling introduced me to them. I don't know, it was just having grown up in a conservative household where, you know, literally I did not own a secular album until I was probably 17 or 18, maybe 16. Anyway, coming out of, I won't name any Christian bands, just not very creative music.
Yes.
They were like a breath of fresh air and a realization for me at a crucial year of just like, wow, music can be huge. Music can be so much more. You can express concepts. You can, you know, anyway. So the Pariah, the Parrot, the Delusion is their 4th record. And to me, it kind of is the best summation of what their sound is and who they are. And what's funny is the concept, so to speak, of this record is has a lot to do with sort of essentially bashing on Christianity and just being like, there is no God.
Yeah.
which is fun. It's still good to hear those
things.
But it's also, so the straightforward concept is it's a letter to the 7 billionth person on earth, which is sort of a response to an essay that Salman Rushdie wrote that was a letter to the 6 billionth person on earth, and which was not that long ago. And now we're almost
to 7.
Yeah. So yeah, it's dark, it's beautiful, it's really widely ranging on instruments and sort of the genres they explore. And they often have these little interludes between songs that are just like a minute of music that ties the rest together. And I mean, I want to say almost all their records start to finish don't have any hard breaks, you know, it's just like I said, one big piece. So yeah, just thematically, lyrically, they've always been really fascinating to me, and they were kind of just, they're kind of just what broke me open to a whole new world of music.
Awesome. So dude, I am excited. I've enjoyed it. I'm excited to dig more into it. It's art rock as a descriptor is not something that I spend a lot of time with right now.
Sure.
I think it was like, I don't know what caused that. I used to be really into it and became that, but I'm not, it's just not something that I listen to a lot right now. And so, I'm excited to have something as like a landing place inside of that instead of, who knows where Google would have taken me otherwise. But yeah, no, I want to spend some more time with them. I'm interested to hear, because I think like that, the cool thing about rock, especially whatever kind of it is that rock for a long time was always this like it was a reaction against the norm, right? As a rule, whatever kind of rock or most kinds of rock were this like rebellious middle finger to whatever that specific artist's like enemy ideology or person or whatever it was, that it was like they used rock music to as like an assault on that thing. Literally 100% of the time, but that was kind of the when you go back and watch like the punk documentaries or whatever it is, right?
Like they're not fit for radio play and they view that as a badge of pride,
right? Totally. It's like this I love rock music that still has a lot of like fuck you in it. And I like other stuff. I mean, like, the war on drugs, I wouldn't say that, like, Lost in the Dream has a lot of fuck you in it. That's still one of my favorite records of 20... It was, in my mind, it was my favorite record of 2014. It's still one of my favorite records of in, like, recent memory. Hmm. But that's... It's cool that rock developed to a place where it became... was very... Maybe it was always nuanced, but where, like, the mainstream... Like, what it meant to be a big rock band mm-hmm. has maybe evolved a lot.
Yeah.
But I do... I am always on the lookout for... stuff, and so I was excited after hearing a bit of it that you picked this, because I'm excited to jump back into this.
Yeah. And for, I mean, so for people who are not familiar, I mean, like, maybe kind of the closest bigger band that they are similar to would be like a Circa Survive.
Okay.
Or I mean, some people might know Ocean Size or Biffy Clyro, or maybe even a little bit Manchester Orchestra. Dredg is like kind of one of those middle tier bands, maybe even lower middle tier as far as their influence and spread, like how yeah. many people physically listen to them. I do not listen to other bands of that type hardly at all anymore. But they are one who, you know, they've stuck with me.
Yeah. So, dude, so let's change gears a little bit.
Yeah.
Let's get into a band that is not small, mm-hmm. And is not maybe historically less significant. Mogwai, you picked Happy Songs for Happy People. There's probably a lot that could be said about Mogwai.
Yeah.
I'm interested to hear about your relationship with Mogwai. Obviously, they are like this super famous, like, street cred mm-hmm. band. They are, I think, like, for people who in some way maybe haven't listened to Mogwai, it's, I mean, you mentioned like post rock stuff before. Mm-hmm. I guess they are like one of the grandfathers of post rock.
They've been checking it out for a long time.
They've been into post rock for a while now.
Yeah.
And so people like, they're like the old school version of like Explosions in the Sky or This Will Destroy You or whatever, right? Mm-hmm. This is Happy Songs for Happy People. I believe this came out in 2003.
Yeah, it's fairly early in their catalog.
Okay.
So this was a record Andy Othling again. he's been like my musical tutor for the past 10 years. That's pretty much true. He bought me this record as a gift for my birthday or Christmas or something, and they're one of his favorite bands. And, you know, all five albums I put on this list were turning points for mm-hmm. me, where it opened me up to a new form of music. And with Mogwai, I think this sounds so dumb, but as a 17 or 18 year old, however old I was, I didn't realize that instrumental music could be so interesting and fascinating. And I guess my only other reference to that would be like soundtracks, movie soundtracks, which some of which I did enjoy, but it was just the concept of basically rock music done instrumentally was new to me at the mm-hmm. time. That seems really silly, but, I never get tired of these songs.
Yeah.
And, just a beautiful record. Yeah.
Yeah. No, that's an interesting point though. I think like for pretty much everybody, all of us have missed the boat on bands and probably at one point in our lives have put some time into trying to revise our own history with a band.
Yeah.
And also have learned about bands that we love now in dumb ways. Right. Mm-hmm. Or mm-hmm. like in just run of the mill things. Like I got into a car, I had no idea that the faint existed. I got out of the car, I knew that the faint existed now.
Yeah.
Right. And it was just, it's like, that's how you interact for the most part, especially when you're younger. Like, I think if you are like a music blogger or whatever, whatever that means, like a someone who writes about music or talks about it a lot, you at that point in your life, you're around it a lot. Mm-hmm. And so maybe you, and I'm not saying that there aren't just like, just genuine music nerds. I'm not saying that.
Sure.
I just mean, it's funny when people sometimes feel like they need to have a great story about how they found a great band. Mm-hmm. And it's like, dude, we all heard it. All of us found out a bit of our favorite bands in our friends' cars at parties by asking who that band was, by like looking up bands that you found out that like a girl you had a crush on liked, and trying to like listen to it and see if you could find a way to like it so she would like you. There's, I mean, there's like maybe 30 ways or something, but it's just everybody has done one of, has done maybe 10 of the 30 things that had happened to them. 10 of the 30 things that happen to you when you find out about a classic band. And that's totally okay. Like, I don't think it actually reduces anyone's pedigree. Like, it just was this thing where I think sort of a part of, maybe this has always been true, but I feel like part of the rise of hipsterism in America was this sort of manufactured pedigree in things, whether it's products or opinions or reading lists, music taste. I mean, it doesn't matter.
Like, you need to have your entire life curated.
Yeah, everything that you've put so much intention into something, and that you have such a like well reasoned and thought out opinion on a thing, or why you don't listen to it, right? Yeah. Like, I went probably 3 years in my early to mid 20s with going to parties and never hearing somebody say that they just didn't like a band because it didn't sound good to them. Right.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah, yeah.
It's been a long time. It took until, I don't know. Yeah. I don't know. I had a few friends who were like that, that worked in music, and I like, they changed the way that I thought about that stuff. Cause I was the same way, but it's just something I look back on and laugh at myself and all of my friends for, and all the people that I decided not to be friends with because they were like that.
Yeah. Like, so, it's simple enough to just be like, yeah, I don't care for it. And that's, the conversation can pretty much stop there.
Yeah, it's like, yeah. It's like, I don't know. I don't like that group. That's
cool. Like, I'm happy for you that you enjoy it.
Yeah. I actually don't have like a huge opinion on them because I don't listen to them.
Yeah.
So like, I don't know much about them.
Right.
Or I do like them a lot, but I listen to them a lot, but I don't know. It's cool. It's good. That's it.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know everything about them.
Right.
I haven't met them.
Right.
I didn't know their brother. Or whatever. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah.
Right. But yeah, no. So Mogwai, I think Mogwai reminds me of that because I like, Mogwai is a band that I feel like, Mogwai is a band that is worthy of loving for many different reasons.
Mm-hmm.
And I think is a band that is 100% equally justifiable to have a huge word count on why you love them, and to just say like, this music really helps me and I can't get enough of it. You know what I mean? I think that they themselves as artists have a almost like what feels like on an artistic level, like a genetic depth to them. But it's also the kind of music that you could know nothing about them. You'd have no idea what the fuck post-rock even means.
Right.
I don't even know that I still understand what post-rock means when people use it now. But like, maybe we're like post-post-rock now. I have no idea. But like, but yeah, it's like Mogwai is one of those bands that just stands up in any context, in my experience. I have loved it through all of my annoying and then hopefully less annoying stages of my life.
Right. Yeah, and they're still putting out music to this day, and like pretty much everything is very solid. You know, it's some of the earlier catalog is a little more, it's a little harder to absorb, but anyway, yeah. This is breaking from the album.
Do it, dude. Yeah,
but and I want to make sure we're okay on time here. I know we've gone for a while. Anyway, I've been reading Chuck Klosterman's newest book.
Oh, yeah.
I'm like, we're wrong?
A quarter of the way through that.
Oh, really?
I listened to it on Audible, so okay. I have short commute, so it's not, I don't make a lot of progress, but yeah.
Yeah. Long story short, I mean, this is the first book I've really read by him, so I couldn't call myself familiar or a fan of him necessarily, and I'm sort of learning as I go on through this book. He has some really interesting thoughts. I don't know how valuable any of them are. And in fact, they might only be like kind of breaking my thinking instead of helping it. But his chapter about music is interesting to me because just the fact that his premise is basically the time we live in now, it's eventually going to be summed up by basically one band.
Mm-hmm.
Just the way that we, classical music, it's like Beethoven, Mozart, Bach, that's classical music, even though there were amazing people at that time that are now dead and dust totally. And we're never going to know them again. Or just the idea of like, you know, it'll probably be either the Beatles or Elvis or Rolling Stones or mm-hmm. like for at least the period directly behind us. Or like Robert Johnson was the iconic right. blues person or something like that. And the reason I want to talk to you about it is because you're a philosophy guy. You absorb a lot of music. And I don't even know if he lands on the same thing as this, but I believe that when whatever we currently call rock fades, that the next sort of main genre is probably going to be hip hop.
Mm-hmm.
Because hip hop right now, even though I don't care for a lot of it, it's probably the most creative genre that has gone to some weird fucking places that I don't know if anybody expected it to.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's some very forward-thinking hip-hop artists, and I don't even like their music, but I can recognize that something's happening there.
Yeah.
I don't know if people will ever stop making music with, like, chuggy guitars and, you know, distortion and just whatever. But I just feel like the way that we view Led Zeppelin and Creedence Clearwater, like, that era, we primarily view it as, like, classic rock.
Mm-hmm.
Most bands that were bands were doing this thing. And so right now it's kind of breaking away from guitar music into trippy ass weird beat hip hop.
Mm-hmm.
So what are your thoughts on that? Being a much bigger fan of hip hop than me.
Yeah, no, I think that's true. I think hip hop is, this has been said by many, 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 many people a million times, but hip hop has taken over for rock and roll. It is the dominant, style. It will continue to be for a while. I think one of the funny things about hip hop, right, is that like all these sort of stuffy rock heads started getting self-righteous about the morality, their perceived morality of rap music for a long time. That probably still happens. It shouldn't happen, only because rappers aren't doing anything different than what Led Zeppelin was doing when they were huge. I mean, Black Sabbath had a fucking private plane that the only reason it existed was to bring them cocaine wherever they were. I mean, like, there is no... It's like this... Hip-hop is just sort of the... Hip-hop is... I think the reason it's the dominant thing is that hip-hop is the genre that is causing our small grouping of generations to confront their evils and past evils. I think like it's the genre that is talking about the most important stuff. And like, I think that we don't need to get into who all that is, obviously. Sure. Kendrick Lamar, but there's a ton of other people.
Right.
It's not just Kendrick Lamar, and then
he's kind whatever. Of like the poster child right now, it seems.
He's a poster child, I think, for I think he is... I love Kendrick Lamar. He's doing incredibly important stuff. He is incredibly talented. He deserves all the praise and probably more than he gets. But I think Kendrick Lamar is the poster child for people who want to talk about how they know rap. And I think stylistically, he's probably the best rapper right now, or one of them. I mean, like, as far as his... And that's a weird thing. Like, the way that people might use an artist doesn't reflect back on that artist. My point being, though, that like, hip hop, I think, has the best things to say about society, like political stuff,
mm-hmm.
Awareness around certain issues, all sorts of things, mm-hmm. than anything else. In my mind, it's not even close. And I think that hip hop basically did. It started maybe with like, man, where did it start? I don't know. That would be a totally different conversation. But like, hip hop absorbed a lot of stuff into it, right? So whether that was via sampling, collaborations, whatever. And now it's like bleeding out into everything, right? Mm-hmm. And so there are other genres that are also overlapping a lot with hip hop, like a new wave of electronic stuff that is like started with this like like trap music exists because of hip hop music, mm-hmm. and like the lines will continue to blur in that direction for a long time. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I think people will look back. I like Klosterman's book. I like him. I have another book of his that is called Eating the Dinosaur. And then I have read like the majority of Sex, Drugs, and Cocoa Puffs, mm-hmm. both of which are very, very, very good. And sorry everybody for the fan that just turned on. That is, I can't control it. We're in the office. It just happens sometimes. Mm-hmm. So to your point about Chuck Klosterman, I think he's great at the idea of like the capital T truth stuff. I think he is sort of the king of, or at least was at one point, kind of like the king of like low culture commentary. Mm-hmm. And by that I mean like he was a huge sports writer. He used to work at Grantland. I think he was one of the guys that helped start Grantland. But he's done a million things. I like his writing a lot. I always find his stuff interesting. So I go back to his book. I don't usually sit down and just cram through a Chuck Klosterman book. Mm-hmm. I read him in the way that I read like Christopher Hitchens, where it's like, oh man, I'd love to read a couple interesting essays on something.
Right.
Hitchens skews political and literary. Klosterman skews like sports and music, mm-hmm. And like pop culture. Right. So I don't, but his new book, yeah, I mean, I think it's an interesting idea. I think that like, I had a conversation exactly like this with the guys from Clipping. They're, a really cool, like, I guess like noise rap group they're signed to Sub Pop. I like them a lot. But we were talking about noise music and about the fact that like people now are so comfortable with, which is something that Klosterman talks about as well. People now are so comfortable with referencing classical music. Mm. And feeling like they understand what the dimensions of classical music are. Mm-hmm. Like at the time, we're like, oh, that sounds like classical music, right? Mm-hmm. And so at the time, there was so much differentiation in composers that like the people listening to it then in that context did not think, oh, I'm listening to another classical composer.
Right, right.
Classical music was not like a thing.
You know,
I don't think it was like self-aware genre that people were like, time to go hear a classical music concert.
Right.
It was just like, that's what music was. Mm-hmm. And it was just maybe because of the church and other things, it was just a pervasive style. There was obviously other styles that existed. But my point is like Western Europe, because what we really mean is in Western Europe, that was the style. It wasn't worldwide. Mm-hmm. People in pretty much every other continent in Europe didn't give a fuck about what became to be known as classical music.
Their own thing,
yeah, they had all their own stuff, and they were like, this is cool, and they probably just didn't even know that, they never knew that Mozart existed, in mm-hmm. like, probably, in like, India. There's somebody who's going to be like, well, what they did, and here's this guy, and so I don't know who that person is. So, if I'm wrong about that, I apologize. But my point being that, like, classical music, to reference classical music as a style is untrue. In the same way that it will be the argument that he's saying for, like, I think does he pick Elvis? I don't remember who the guy is. Maybe it was in an interview where he was, like, talking about, I think it was Elvis, but maybe it wasn't. Maybe it was, I don't think it was Dylan. Anyway, where he's like, this is probably the person that people will look back on, like, the 19th/20th century music basically all sounded like Elvis or Dylan or whatever. And the thing is that for most people who go back and listen around it, the listening library will be like, we'll start with somebody like Elvis, right? Mm-hmm. Like just in the same way that it does with Mozart or Beethoven. And those are like your inputs into the world. So when you're listening back to quote unquote classical music, you feel like these guys are your stepping stones, the famous stepping stones down into classical music. Mm-hmm. And then it's like, then you meet these people who know, like, knowing like 20 classical composers by name for most people means that person's IQ is like in another stratosphere from your own. You're like, holy shit, that person knows 20 composers by name.
Yeah.
You know, like,
as opposed to five.
Oh yeah. As opposed to the five that I might know, or the seven or the 13. It doesn't matter. Like, you hit these tiers when you're talking to people about classical music. And of course, they're probably dropping the names that are the most obscure for their own reasons that we don't care about for this conversation. But my point being that, like, if that will happen to our time, I agree with you, that will happen to every time. I think that rap will be the thing. Mm-hmm. I think that, like, it's hard to know who will be at the top of that pile, because I think that people... So history is kind of... Klosterman talks about this. History is basically curated by nerds. right? Mm-hmm. And so, like, and it's only, in the past, it's only been, like, a few nerds. And right. so that's why, like, everybody's like, well, I've read Livy's History of Rome, so that means that I know everything about Rome. And it's like, no, dude, you know everything that Livy wanted to tell you about Rome. Yeah. And it was mostly just his opinion on a bunch of stuff. Right. But now it's the world's opinion because we have his stuff. And most people read that because it's, like, at Barnes & Noble for $20, right? But my and it's, like, up front or something. It's like, oh, my God, I need to learn about the classical world. I guess I'll do this. My point being that, like, that there will be a Livy, or maybe there will be a Livy of modern music. Mm-hmm. Who will be like, this is who it was at some point.
Right.
Maybe that person will be a robot. I don't know. Like, one of the cool things about AI is, like, maybe AI will help us remember times more, in a more nuanced way. Mm-hmm. Right. So maybe having humans not curate history at some point will actually be really useful, because there would be at least less, hypothetically less bias and more onus put on things that were aligned with some more objective standard of significance than just somebody's personal research, basically, right? I have no idea if that will happen. So my point being, if that were to happen, maybe modern music would avoid that, where it's just like, oh yeah, in the 20th century, everything sounded like Lil Wayne. Mm-hmm. But it's also true that 1,000 years from now, going back and listening to modern music, people will probably legitimately have opinions that are like, everything basically sounded like Lil Wayne back then. Mm-hmm. Doesn't matter who it was, like Glenn Hansard and like Flume and The National and Andre Bocelli and U2, this weird band called U2, who like did this tour about their first album or whatever. Anyway, like this whole, everybody will go back and list all these names and be like, yeah, man, so there was like this artist, Lil Wayne, and they all sounded like him. So, like, if you want a starting place, go listen to the Carter Three, and then after that, go and listen to Joshua Tree and Boxer and this Once soundtrack and like this jazz artist that hasn't even put out, or like Kamaya Washington. And anyway, you could just do a complete 360-degree mm-hmm. circle of modern music and link it into somebody like Lil Wayne, and that's probably what will happen, right? Mm-hmm. I don't know if it would be Lil Wayne. That's not my argument. But anyway, so yeah, I think it will be a rapper that happens to. Mm-hmm. And I think that, like, I'm excited for history to reflect back on the development of hip-hop, because I think it is, like, the development of hip-hop is the most fascinating topic. It's one that, like, I am just starting to read more on. Mm-hmm. But it's, like, in my mind, it's the most fascinating genre development in American music history, for me, personally. Mm-hmm. And it's tied way back into a lot of other elements. So it's not, like, maybe saying less so than like, jazz. But just, like, that spine is, like, super fascinating to me. And it's cool that it's now, like, blooming again. Like, if you have sort of this vine that runs through, mm-hmm. it's like that's blooming again, and probably there's an argument to be made that, like, African American music is just all American music, mm-hmm. and has just been copied and pasted into other things by other artists outside of that. I think there's probably a legitimate point to be made about that, but that's not what we're here to do. Sure. So I don't, that was a really long answer to your question. I apologize, but yeah. I think that, like, yeah, I think it will be hip hop in the same way that it was rock. I mean, if depending on how they boil it down, mm-hmm. if they were to go by 30-year segments, then, like, from the 50s to the 80s, it was rock, right? Yeah. Rock was saying all the important stuff. It was pushing against all the important stuff. It was explaining a lot of shit that was just more like, we fuck this war and fuck all the, like, conservative people.
Right.
Anyway, so, yeah. So, yeah. I think, like, that template, if we're going to take templates from other things, I think that applies the most. It aligns the most. That template would align the most with hip-hop, I think. Mm-hmm. And it's why I think everyone, no matter their age, should be listening to a lot more of it. But I'm not here to convince you of that. So, tell me about... I'm interested, speaking of the classical world, the fall of Troy. I know a little bit about the mytho-historical event, the fall of Troy, because I was a classics major, one of those annoying people. I have no idea who the fuck this band is. Mm-hmm. And I'm excited to find out. Their album is Manipulator.
Yeah.
Yeah, take me through it.
Okay. So Fall of Troy is also... Well, okay, I'll just say simply, they were kind of one of the first heavier bands that I listened to ever. Once again, introduced to me by my friend Andy. And they are... Oh, just these kids, basically, from the Seattle, Washington area, who put out their first record when they were, like, 17, and their guitarist, it's just a three-piece, drums, bass, guitar. Their guitarist is kind of one of those prodigy guys who was, like, shredding when he was 13 or something ridiculous, I don't know.
Yeah.
Their music is extremely chaotic and often dissonant, and, I don't know, it's not, there's... this is a whole different topic. There's so many realms and bands and genres of hardcore and metal and just heavy music in general. Theirs to me is like, I don't even know. I don't know. It's like a cassette tape getting all scrambled up in the player and like, you know, coming apart to shreds and, that's a dumb way to say it. No. But it's just, the guitar isn't just sitting still or doing chords. It's running up and down and doing all these, octaves and or pentatonics or the little, I can't think of the term, whatever.
Yeah.
My brain is gone.
I don't know. I've never shredded on a guitar.
Yeah. It's just crazy music. And this guy is singing while he's playing all this. And I've seen him live and he can really do it. And it was just the fact Manipulator was their second full-length record. It came out when they were in their, like, 20 years old. One of the guys, I think, was still 17 or 18. And you listen to it and it's just very sophisticated, smart, heavy music for really young kids to be making. And that's kind of why they're sort of remarkable. And I don't listen to a lot of heavy music. A lot of it I just can't stomach and I don't enjoy it. And, that's about it.
Yeah.
But they are one of those that I just think they're doing something very interesting. It is unique. It is, to my ears, it's just not a lot of bands are doing this particular thing. So, yeah, I don't know if I have much more to say about that. But I guess they were a stepping off point for me for other heavy music. Oddly enough, they led me to things like Mastodon or, He Is Legend is sort of a different blend of like Southern rock heavy music. And I don't know. Yeah.
Huh.
I realized that I was able to enjoy screamy, heavy, crazy stuff.
Yeah. I think the band for me for that was like... Death Grips, but then a friend of mine just totally slammed me for calling Death Grips a metal band, and so then I just gave up. I was like, I really like Death Heaven, and so I've listened to Sunbather a lot and whatever, but I think that metal music has been this thing that has come in and out of my life largely dependent on who I'm like closest friends with at any given time. And I don't think it's not a genre that has ever like taken over my life. We've got a super sharp metal dude, Andy O'Connor or Andy. Yeah. Andy. Wow. Sorry, Andy. Either Andy Connor or Andy O'Connor. I'm for some reason remember or forgetting that. Sorry, Andy. But the point is he's brilliant with metal music. He writes a metal column for us. It's actually one of my minor goals for this year is to start listening to more of the stuff that he puts in his column, because it is like this world that I just have not really explored very much. But I know enough people who are like metalheads to know that there's a lot to get into potentially.
Right.
I know what you mean where it's just like something comes out of nowhere from a genre and it's just, okay, I like this thing, I guess.
Right.
If there's more stuff like that, I guess maybe I'd be into it.
Right.
Kind of thing.
Yeah. And this particular one, just to say briefly, it was one of those albums that I bought it and like driving around in my car listening to the CD, I was the first listen, I was like, oh shit, like I'm gonna hate this. Mm-hmm. Like I just wasted $13 basically. So and those tend to be my favorites, are not the ones that I love immediately, but the ones that you have to sit with. I know that's been documented by tons of people everywhere, but that was one of those. Yeah.
Yeah.
It took some time.
So I this last one is on some level maybe the most obvious title mm-hmm. on this list.
Sure.
But also I think one of those records that for me still very much stands up years later yeah. in the way, same way that like Hot Fuss by The Killers does. Mm-hmm. This is Absolution by MUSE.
Right.
I don't know that this is true. I feel like anyone under the age of like 37 or 38 mm-hmm. has had a time in their life when they were really into MUSE.
Yeah,
that is a huge generalization, but I feel like MUSE for a brief window of time was like the biggest band on the planet for a certain age group at least.
Right.
And sorry everybody for the footsteps. That is our upstairs neighbor going about their literal business. but yeah, I mean, I think like they were huge, mm-hmm. and then they're still putting music out. I haven't listened to a MUSE song in a really long time. A new MUSE song in sure. a really long time.
Yeah.
It's, you know, probably just the requisite thing that happens to fans of bands yeah. at certain times in their life. The new MUSE music could be really good. I have no idea.
Mm-hmm.
But I know that this record's very good. Tell me about your specific stuff with Absolution.
Right. Something about it just felt very big, very classy, sort of like, I don't know, music for intellectuals in a way, kind of. And that's it's funny because I would not say that anymore about them, but or about their newer records. But the, you know, from the very first moment of like the marching sounds and then the piano that comes in, it just felt, it felt like a movie soundtrack. It felt like you were about to go on a like an epic adventure. I know epic is overused now.
Yeah, no, but it sticks.
Yes. So yeah, and it's now become kind of one of these iconic records of British rock, you know. Mm-hmm. And I don't know, MUSE is really interesting to me because I would say at the time I bought this record, and then when their next one came out, Black Holes and Revelations, I think they were kind of at their peak, or maybe only for my age group at the time. But yeah, I just thought these guys are enormous. They're like they're an entity, and you go see them live and you're like, how are three guys making this much sound? I'm sure they had samples and things playing, you know, along with them. But yeah, to me, it was artful, creative. I loved the integration of like very beautiful piano with, also with like digital sounds and distorted bass, and it just felt like something very special and big and different, and almost like the purest form of a perfect record. You know, like they got it, they found that lightning in a bottle. And not to be this guy, but I guess I am going to be this guy, but the last two albums, which I gave a cursory listen to, I really am just like, what the fuck are they doing? Like, I think that I do truly believe they've kind of lost their way, and now they're just doing the writing, churning out arena songs for like Twilight fans.
Right.
And in a weird way, to briefly say, I feel like Coldplay did the same thing. People shit on Coldplay, whatever. I actually think their first four records were fantastic pieces of music.
Mm-hmm.
Up to Viva La Vida, Coldplay was a very good band. And now they've become kind of a meme, and like people don't like Chris Martin, whatever. I don't care about any of that. Their music was good. Milo Xyloto, I truly think they stopped trying mm-hmm. at all. And I just don't understand that. And I don't know what it's like to be an artist of that caliber and have that many people paying attention to you. I mean, maybe guys get burned out. Maybe they don't give a shit. Maybe they thought they had made the best records of their lives with the last
totally.
Few. But anyway, those two bands kind of stick in my mind as like they're huge British entities. And even, you know, it could be argued there's some crossover in genre. MUSE is heavier, but whatever. That was a long answer, but yeah, I still feel like Absolution holds up by today's standards, as you said. And yeah, I still listen to their sort of holy trinity of records of Absolution and then Origin of Symmetry and Black Holes and Revelations. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, no, I mean, I think it's good to sort of conflate those two bands. I think, so my impression of Absolution is that, like, Absolution was, like, the perfect record to for people who didn't necessarily have a nuanced explanation of what a perfect record entailed. Because I think it is, I think you're right, it is like this lightning in a bottle, sort of perfect intersection of so many things. And I'm hoping the people upstairs stop moving around sometime soon. I just remember it hit me like a semi-truck when I was, I don't know, 16. I don't remember how old I was when this record came out, exactly. But I remember that this record took over my life for a while. Kind of in the same way that Thursday had, like Full Collapse did, maybe like a year, a while prior to this. Sure. I think a band like Muse, for me, and Coldplay are... I agree with you. I love Coldplay. I stan publicly, and I will again now, it seems like. I stan very publicly for Ghost Stories. It's like one of my favorite Coldplay records of all time.
Interesting.
But I think like... But I agree with you, and I think that the idea that... In the same way I think that Coldplay... They have always made arena rock, right? Like, mm-hmm. They have always been an arena band. And what I mean by that is that they have always... Their music is packed with emotion that is, like, untrue. Like, you can attach your own emotion to it.
Yeah.
But, like, dude, love is not, like, the kind of... Real love is not at all... Mm-hmm. Like what Chris Martin is talking about in
it's
his
kind of like the Disney film version.
Totally,
of
yes,
life,
yes. Yeah. And I think in that same way, I think Muse is like the Disney version of an existential crisis. Like it was like the existential crisis for kids in high school and college who like hadn't actually had one yet, right? Mm-hmm. And it was like I'm really going through a tough time. When you don't know what a tough time really actually can mean. Mm-hmm. And I don't mean that even as a diss. I just mean, like, I feel like a lot of people like myself and my friends latched on to Muse because angst was an abstraction. And there was, like, it was this time that you can look back on, I think, in your life where you, like, verifiably didn't know almost anything. And so, like, your opinions and your anger against institutional stuff, like, was not just like uninteresting on some level to somebody who wasn't your age, but also was untrue. Like, only because, like, let's say, and what I mean by this is, like, it was just 95% emotion, like, not really backed up by anything. And I'm not saying every teenager is like that. I'm just saying, in general, Muse was this, like, arena fist at the sky that explained, that was, like, the voice of your sort of oatmeal-y, like, half-soupy, like, rage against the outside world as this machine that was there to disassemble you while it's laughing at you. Like, it was music for kids. It was party music for kids that didn't realize yet that the universe doesn't even know that you exist. Almost. You know what I mean? In the sense that you, like, you get up and that there's, like, bands that maybe are even wrestling in their lyrics with some of the same stuff that, like, that Muse is. But it's, like, this gigantic... And I'm not saying the people in Muse aren't intelligent. I'm just saying that I think that, like, I've gone back to their lyrics some and stuff, and it's just like, man... This meant so much to me at some point, and this doesn't explain anything to me anymore. Hmm. Does that make sense? And I think I still love listening to this record. Right. I love Muse because they were so fucking good at that like crazy bass attack, yeah. Like for arena rock, you know, where it's just like I saw them open for U2 like a bazillion years ago, mm-hmm. and they start as soon as almost every one of their songs played that like anyone would know, mm-hmm. the whole place was like ballistic,
yeah,
right, and there were not that many bands that could play a football stadium and get everyone ballistic like that. Mm-hmm. And that was like their real talent. But also I think, I agree. I think that the Absolution stuff has substance in it. It's not that it's not substantive. I just don't even know. Anyway, so there's a lot maybe of a relationship between like fans and artists that goes into that. But my point being, I think Absolution very much does stand up. Mm-hmm. I still love that record. Muse is a band that I really want to be good again in a nostalgic way. I think in the same way that I feel about, Interpol.
Oh, sure.
Like I would lose my shit for a really good Interpol record right now.
Uh-huh.
You know, I don't know. I was just really into Interpol, but yeah. Not everybody was. Mm-hmm. They weren't as big as Muse.
Sure.
I don't think.
No.
I don't think so. But yeah, man. Well, dude, this has been great.
Yeah.
We have traveled far and wide over the course of this. Thank you for being on the show, man.
Thank
Everybody
you.
Listening, you can find Josh on the internet as Dr. Gaines. That goes for Facebook and Twitter.
Mm-hmm.
You can buy his books on Amazon. You can search on Amazon by his name, Dr. Gaines. You can listen to his podcast. Is it every week? Is it just,
yep.
Is it every week? Ink and Echo. It's on iTunes. Just type in Ink and Echo.
Yep.
You had David Bazan on there.
Yeah.
You have a lot of different people on. Like it seems like a
right.
pretty interesting smattering of folks.
Yeah.
But you check that podcast out. Keep an ear/eye out for Cordial Kill, his short film that is coming out sometime soon. And Josh, it's been a pleasure.
Yeah, thanks so much.
As
man.
Always. And
you
everybody
are.
Listening, thank you so much for listening. We love you. We will talk to you next week.
Yo, being hella brash is the swag, bruh. Sitting back and I'm getting ass in Nebraska. Different flats in a different class, rolling grass up. New age, only spitting facts, no wax stuff. Yeah, that's how we do.